the way that the state and the children's message, if you told them what the number 153 meant. Anybody here know? Supposedly, that's the number of varieties of fish that are in the sea by rivers. So they're called one of these fish. I'm not preaching on that today, though. Preaching on small and days. Our first lesson for today is most typically known as Saul's conversion story, his Damascus Road experience. And it describes a dramatic encounter between Saul and Jesus on the road to Damascus. The encounter that started Saul down a new path that would make him the most prolific evangelist of the early church and the most prolific writer of the entire New Testament. This passage also describes another encounter, a less dramatic, a less well-known encounter. And it's between Jesus and another guy. You know him as Ananias. Saul usually gets all of the attention in this story. But today I invite you to pay attention to Ananias also. Ananias is a common foot soldier in the Lord's army. He doesn't get a lot of attention. Nobody really remembers him. The Lord didn't blind him with a bright light. The Lord didn't change his name. The Lord didn't send him to any far-off places where he would suffer floggings and imprisonment and shipwrecks. The Lord did not give him an assignment to go out and to change the entire world so that our world will still be reveling from the impact of, like Saul. But the Lord did give Ananias an assignment to change the world for one person. And for that reason, it's worth paying as much attention to this account of the encounter between Ananias and Jesus as it is to the account of the encounter between Saul and Jesus. Now, you and I may never be asked to go out and to change the world. You and I will be asked from time to time to go and change the world for one person. We don't know a lot about Ananias. He was a disciple of Jesus. He lived in Damascus. Later in Acts, Paul describes him as a devout observer of the law and respected by all the Jews in Damascus. We don't know if Ananias had been a follower of Jesus for a short time or a long time. We do know that he knew Jesus. We know that he had been in Damascus long enough to know and to be respected by the Jews and by the Jewish Christians who lived there. Now, Saul did not know Jesus. He knew of the name of Jesus, of course. It had become Saul's entire career to know the name of Jesus and to go out and to root out all of his followers. And Saul was from Tarsus. He was a Jew who was born in Roman citizenship. He was a Pharisee. He was a student and adherent of the law. Highly educated under the tutelage of the most famous rabbi of the first century. Back in Jerusalem, Saul watched over all the coats of those who stoned Stephen to death. And now here he is on his way to Damascus, the nearest important city outside of the Holy Land. And he is breathing out murderous threats against all of the Lord's disciples. And he carries letters from the high priest there in Jerusalem to all of the synagogues in Damascus so that if he finds any of these followers of Jesus among the Jews in Damascus, he might arrest them. Damascus, Saul encountered Jesus. Shortly thereafter in Damascus, Ananias hears from Jesus also. Two very different encounters happening here. Both are very important to the future of the church. Both with a lot to teach us about what to expect when Jesus decides to give one of us an assignment, whether it's a big one or a small one. The first thing to notice here is that Jesus seems to be willing to give assignments to those who recognize his voice and to those who do not. To those who are walking in the path of discipleship faithfully, and to those who are resolutely walking in the wrong direction entirely. Now, Saul was an enemy of Jesus. He was out to take some heads. And when he heard the Lord's call to him, he had to ask. He said, "Who are you, Lord?" And if you think you have to get all of your act entirely together before Jesus will ever consider calling upon you, stop and think again. Because sometimes it is only Jesus' call that lets us know that we don't have our act together. Now Ananias, he was a disciple of Jesus, just trying to keep out the line of fire. And when he heard the Lord call his name, he recognized the Lord, and he answered, "Yes, Lord." Now, if you think you are safe from any further nudges from the Lord now that you've made that decision to follow him, you might as well think again also. The call to turn in his direction the first time is actually only the beginning. He will continue to call upon you to change the world one person at a time for all the rest of your life. Second thing to notice here is if the Lord wants to get your attention, he's quite capable of doing it. Now, Ananias seems to be tuned in to the Lord. And when the Lord called, he heard him immediately. Now Saul, he was tuned in to one other thing. His zealous pursuit of the followers of the way. Saul was so intensely focused that he was intensely focused on the wrong thing. The Lord had to get his attention before he could do anything else with Saul. And so he did. As he neared Damascus on his journey, suddenly a light from heaven flashed all around Saul. And Saul fell to the ground and he was blinded. For 3 days he did not eat or drink, and he was dependent on his men to lead him around by the hand. I don't know about you, but that would get my attention. And it got his attention. Saul's Damascus Road experience reminds me a lot of Moses' burning bush experience. That was another occasion when God wanted to get somebody's attention. Now Moses was inattentive. His inattentiveness was not a matter of being focused on the wrong thing. Moses' problem was that he had spent so many years out there wandering around in the desert with his sheep that he had stopped focusing so much on anything. And that burning bush got his attention. Now, whether our inattentiveness is due to intense focus on the wrong thing, or a lack of focus on anything in particular. God is quite capable of getting our attention when He wants to. Thirdly, God has His own reasons for handing out assignments in life. This assignment to this person and this assignment to that person. Stop and think about it. Here's Ananias. He's in Damascus. He's a very faithful disciple. He's attentive to the Lord's voice. He's well respected by all of the Jews. He knows the law and he observes it. He lives outside of the Holy Land, and so he must be at least somewhat familiar with the ways of the Gentiles. Have you ever stopped and wondered why God went to all the trouble to get Saul's attention when he already had people like Ananias available? God chose a zealous Pharisee, an active and murderous persecutor of the church, to carry the good news to all of the Gentiles. I don't know about you, but based on the results, I guess God knew what He was doing. Do you suppose Ananias ever wondered why he did nothing? He got selected to go to Saul. I would guess that most of the Christians in Damascus, they were going underground when they heard that Saul was on his way to Damascus. And Ananias, he was the lucky one who got the assignment to go forth and to risk arrest and even worse, maybe even his life, by confronting Saul. Why Ananias? Well, I don't know. But based on the results, I guess God knew what He would do. Fourth, sometimes when God calls, the next thing you have to do is to wait. When Jesus confronted Saul on the road to Damascus, He asked Saul one question, and then He gave Saul one instruction. Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? And then the instruction, get up and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do. The men with Saul led him by the hand now to the city. For 3 days, he could see nothing but darkness. He ate and drank nothing. He waited and waited and prayed. He received a vision that a man by the name of Ananias would come and would place his hands upon him and would restore his sight. And he waited some more. God had a tremendous task to set before Saul. But his first task was to wait. This is not a task that he could do under his own power or with his own wisdom. He needed to let the Lord lead him one step at a time. Fifth, sometimes when the Lord calls, the next thing you have to do is go. When the Lord gave Ananias his assignment, Ananias had time to ask the Lord one question. Lord, I have heard many reports about this man and all of the harm that he has done to saints in Jerusalem. And he has come here with authority from the chief priest to arrest everyone who calls on your name. In other words, he's saying, are you sure this is the man you want me to go see? And the Lord responds with one instruction. Go. The outcome of this observation is that when God gives you an assignment in this life, you always have the choice to say yes or no. You always have the freedom to obey or to disobey. Now that said, sometimes it's clear that you have to say yes, even when your insides are crying out in fear, no, no, no! And it seems this was the case with Ananias. He was understandably concerned about going to see Saul, but God said, go! And he went. Sixth, sometimes when the Lord calls, he has to do a lot of changing in you before you can go out and change the world. When Saul lost his sight for 3 days, more was going on than just a physical reaction to a really bright light. The Lord was letting Saul know just how blind he had been. That his rejection of Jesus was a result of blindness. That his zealousness in persecuting the church was the result of blindness. That even his devotion to the law was blind devotion. Then when Ananias laid his hands upon Saul, scales fell from his eyes. More was going on than just physical healing of damaged eyes. The Lord was signaling to Saul the dramatic changes that would happen in his life now that he could see Jesus clearly. So before Saul could even be given his assignment, he had to do a lot of repenting and turning from his old ways. Before Saul could even be given his assignment, first, the Lord had to do a lot of healing within Saul. Before Saul could even be given his assignment, he had to come to know Jesus. Seventh, sometimes when the Lord calls, it will turn your life completely upside down, and nothing will ever be the same again. Sometimes when the Lord calls, it is simply time to do your task and to return to your life. Either way, when the Lord calls, he will often call you and me out of our comfort zones. Saul was focused on a purpose of his own. He never expected the Lord to encounter him on that road to Damascus. He never expected to have his life completely turned upside down. He never expected to become an evangelist for Jesus Christ. But the Lord called him, and nothing was ever the same for him. Now, Ananias was understandably concerned about this idea of going to see Saul. It just didn't make a lot of sense to him. And it involved taking a considerable risk. But the Lord called, and he responded. For one brief moment, one very brief moment in all of life, he stepped into the spotlight. In response to God's call. Then he simply stepped into the background again. And he went on with his life. The Lord provided Saul with everything that he needed to fulfill his assignment in life. And the Lord provided Ananias with everything that he needed to fulfill his assignment. And my friends, the Lord will provide you and me everything that we need.